Welcome to So Jeongwook Art Talk. Today's artwork is Jacques-Louis David's Intervention of the Sabine Women. This story is taken from Rome's foundation mythology. Rome's founding king Romulus faced a problem. There was a lack of Roman women. So his kingdom couldn't grow to be the powerful kingdom he envisaged. He had a plan. He wanted to invade neighboring peoples and steal their women. The people he had in mind were the Sabines. Roman soldiers launched a surprise attack on the Sabines and captured many women and made them their wives. So how did the Sabine men react? A few years later, they regrouped and launched an attack on Rome. They could get their revenge and take back their kidnapped daughters. But something unexpected happened. The Sabine women, instead of embracing their rescuers, tried to stop the fighting. Their daughter's view was, "There's no one left in Rome for you to save. If you keep fighting, all you'll do is deprive husbands of their wives and children of their mothers." You see, the Sabine women had already been married for some years, and a lot of them bore children. The Sabine men had nothing to say in response. It's a story about how the two countries came together as one. Jacques-Louis David has depicted the moment the Sabine women interrupt the fighting. His picture has a few unique points, and in order to explain them clearly, let's look at a painting of the same topic. Both of these pictures are titled The Intervention of the Sabine Women. The top is the work of David. The bottom was painted by Giulio Romano. First impressions? Doesn't the bottom seem a little busy? Obviously, any scene of war would look busy, but this one isn't easy to take in. Remember our two artworks before? The coronation of Napoleon I and the oath of the Horatii? These works dealt with difficult subjects in clear, concise language. There might not have been much emotion in each, but they are memorable images. This is a characteristic of David. He leaves little room for sentimentality. His work is painted symbolically. And so David doesn't try to make work for mere appreciation. If you remember, he makes his work exaggerated to provide a kind of moral education. So then, what would the lesson in this work be? Let's have a look. The woman in the center is the first thing that catches the eye. Decked out in white clothes like a goddess, with her arms spread wide, looking like a beacon of light amongst the darkness, with one foot forward, she intervenes in the fighting. The intervening heroine is Hercilia. And while a daughter of Sabine, she is now the wife of Roman King Romulus. Who is she staring at with that look in her eyes? That soldier at the front of the Roman lines is her husband, King Romulus. Together, they already have a child. Once more, David attempts to ease the confusion. Look at the shield. On it is emblazoned Roma. And the image of two children suckling a she-wolf. This is the symbol of Rome. Rome was founded by these twins, one of which is Romulus, who gave his name to the state. Romulus is brandishing his spear, but he's taken one step back. He sees no way to avoid battle, however, he will not be the first to strike. Now look opposite him. Who is the man lowering his sword and opening his shield and standing a little awkwardly? This is the king of Sabine, Hercilia's father, and he is a little taken aback by the actions of his daughter, whom he thought would welcome his rescue. Look at his left leg. You can see a Sabine woman with a child grasping his leg so that he can't fight. Let's look at the rest of the women. Among them is this woman, stood on a stone plinth, lifting her child aloft and shouting something. Probably something like, "Stop the attack. You have grandchildren now." And one woman is pushing her children out in front. Is there any better way to stop the fighting? Let's look at the full picture. First, Rome. One soldier is turning back. He wants to go home. Behind him, a veteran soldier on horseback sheathes his sword again. And the Roman spears behind, facing skywards. Their helmets hung on the spearheads. The Romans have no taste for war. Now let's look at the Sabines. Their spears are set at the enemy because they came for war. But now, they're surprised by the intervention of their daughters. That's about it for the painting's contents. Now you can appreciate how David neatly arranges such a hectic scene for us to see. Shall we compare it to the picture we saw earlier? Can you see the difference? David, through the use of ancient Roman legend, is relaying a message of peace and reconciliation. This is the work's moral lesson. Let's consider the backdrop of this work's creation. David, a painter who received plaudits from Louis XVI for his ability, at the time of the French Revolution, changed his stance to be on the side of the revolutionaries. Through his skill and his paintings, David ascended to a position of leadership. He even voted in favor of the execution of his former patron Louis XVI. For this reason, David's wife, a royalist, requested a divorce. At any rate, David too lost favor with the radical Robespierre and soon found himself in prison. At that time, a lot of the ringleaders were being executed. However, David appealed for mercy. He was just a painter after all. Luckily, David was spared the guillotine. After a few years, David painted the intervention of the Sabine women. Unlike the other two works that we've looked at, this wasn't a commission. It was a personal project. He wanted to leave behind a moral work. So David held an exhibition in the Louvre and charged an admission fee. Not only did this fee cover the painting's expense, but many people came to receive his tale of morality. This was the first such paying exhibition of its sort. Although it was an experimental method, the results paid off. David received a substantial sum from the admission fee, and during 5 years, around 50,000 visitors came to see his painting. This was the start of a new kind of exhibition. This time, let's look at the painting from another angle. Where did David learn how to execute such an emotionally detached, intricately detailed, yet easily read artwork? Where did he get his ideas? Where did he get his ideas? The answer lies in ancient Greece and Rome. Hence, his style was dubbed neoclassicism. Let's have a look at how he's reinterpreting ancient Greece and Rome in his pictures. There might be some questions. Why are the soldiers all fighting naked? Did they really fight like this? Of course they wore armor in battle. The reason is David's fascination with classical art. Treasures hidden since 2,000 years before David's birth were starting to appear. This was the start of the excavation of Pompeii, which had been buried under the ash of Mount Vesuvius. From its excavation, beautiful artworks were being unearthed. They were mostly sculptures, wall art, and architectural works. Paintings don't really survive 2,000 years of being buried. So the Greek and Roman art that we know is mainly sculpture. The men, women, and children of his paintings all resemble Greek sculptures. And the expressionless faces, characteristic of neoclassicism, easily explained when we consider this. More emphasis has been put on dynamic forms. And David's neoclassicism shows no traces of brushwork. It has a smooth appearance, just like marble statues. Lastly, let's take a look at the infants at the bottom. Two of them are looking directly at the viewer. One has a vacant look on his face, while one stares angrily. David has painted these, thinking ahead of the viewers he anticipates for his exhibition. What could they be saying to us? Here's another feature of neoclassicism. It's meticulous planning and execution, and all the sketches involved. This is the last painting we'll look at from David. When we think of David, we think of words like Louvre, Napoleon, neoclassicism, and politics. Next time, let's take a look at a new artist's work. Have a wonderful day.
Nice to meet you. Everyone, it's time to like, subscribe, and turn on notifications. See you next time.